Hi, I'm Dr. Don Brown, CEO of LifeOmic. Put simply, intermittent fasting is the periodic starvation of your cells. Your body consists of roughly 30 trillion, or 3 times 10 to the 13th cells. In some ways, you can think of your body as the crowd at a concert. When viewed from a distance, it looks like one well-coordinated organism. Examined up close, however, you see distinct individuals. Just like a person interacts with the outside environment by way of his or her senses, cells are able to tell what's going on around them. They do this mostly by means of receptors, proteins embedded within their outside surfaces, their membranes. They generate signals when something important happens. These signals must make their way into the nucleus in order to tell the DNA there to respond by producing additional proteins. It turns out that these signaling pathways are hugely important in cancer and other diseases. Do you know what signal has perhaps the most powerful influence on cells? Insulin, which is a hormone that tells the cell there's sugar available in the bloodstream. Just like a person, each cell has to eat in order to produce energy. And just as for us, the main categories of nutrition are carbohydrates, proteins, and fat. A surprising discovery was made about 30 years ago that depriving an organism of food, starving it, actually made it healthier and live longer. This observation was initially made in single-celled organisms, but was eventually reproduced in worms, flies, mice, and even our close evolutionary cousins, rhesus monkeys. A famous article from about 2010 shows a picture of two monkeys at the equivalent of almost 80 human years. One had been allowed to eat as much as it wanted, while the other had been strictly maintained on a diet with 30% fewer calories. Biologists were stunned at the difference. They found that not only did such caloric restriction cause animals to live longer, it also largely eliminated diseases typically observed in older animals. The race was on to understand why. We'll go into the details in later videos, but the short version is that in recent years, it's been learned that we don't need to permanently starve ourselves in order to realize the benefits of caloric restriction. In fact, all we have to do is starve ourselves for a few hours on a regular basis. That process has come to be known as intermittent fasting, sometimes referred to as IF. You see, we weren't designed to eat around the clock. Our ancestors didn't have refrigerators and boxes of cookies within arm's reach. In most cases, ancient humans feasted when they brought down an antelope or other animal, and then they might have to go days before eating again. Our modern lifestyle floods our cells with inappropriate signals. In essence, insulin is knocking on our cellular doors almost all the time, and that's really bad for us. Intermittent fasting allows us to give ourselves a break from this noise. And as we'll see, this provides an opportunity for repair and regeneration. When people learn about intermittent fasting, their first question is, how long do I have to fast? It's important to understand that we're able to store energy in our bodies in two main forms. It's kind of like having two batteries. Once we've used up all the food from our most recent meal, we tap into the first battery, which is our glycogen store. Glycogen is just a string of sugars, glucose molecules, and is a form of carbohydrate. These carbs are deposited mainly in our livers and our muscles. The glycogen stored in our liver is especially important, as it's used to maintain our blood glucose levels between meals. Depending upon our size and sex, this storage will run our bodies for about 12 hours after a meal. During this period, glycogen from the liver is broken down into glucose molecules, which are pumped into the blood for use by the brain and other organs. When glycogen stores are depleted, a wonderful thing happens. Sensing that the first battery is empty, our bodies switch over to a second battery, which is comprised of our fat. Fat molecules are broken down into smaller pieces called fatty acids and sent into the bloodstream, from which they can be taken up and used by various organs. For most of us, this is a big battery that can run our bodies for days and even weeks as long as we take in water. There's just one problem with this scheme. The brain can't take up fatty acids. It mainly runs on glucose. So when the glycogen battery is empty, we've got a serious problem. The way our body solves this is through a process called ketogenesis. The liver absorbs some of those fatty acids from the blood and breaks them into smaller molecules called ketones that can be absorbed by the brain and used as fuel. In fact, after fasting for a couple of days, 70% of the brain's energy is supplied by ketones. The elevated level of ketones in the blood is referred to as ketosis. So once we've been fasting for 12 or so hours, here's the picture. The glycogen in the liver is gone. Fat cells start pumping fatty acids into the blood. Most cells other than the brain and red blood cells take up the fatty acids and burn them. The liver turns some of the fatty acids it takes up into ketones and pumps them back into the blood. The brain and red blood cells use these ketones for their energy. When the cells switch from metabolizing glucose or sugar to burning fatty acids or ketones, amazing things happen. The bottom line is that the cell interprets this switch as a sign of bad times to come. It's an effect of starvation, after all. You might know that you'll be eating again in a few hours, but your cells have no idea. They've got to prepare for the worst, and they do. They start recycling like mad, breaking down old proteins and building shiny new power plants called mitochondria in order to be as efficient with their energy production as possible. Imagine you were alone in a cabin in winter in Alaska. If there were lots of wood around, when you started to get cold, you'd just grab another log and throw it on the fire. You probably wouldn't worry about the wood chips on the floor or the soot in the chimney. You might relax and read a few good books. Now, imagine that you get snowed in and realize that you might run out of wood and freeze to death. All of a sudden, you'd be much more motivated to use every piece of bark available. You'd do everything you could to keep your fireplace clean and efficient to extract every last bit of heat you possibly could from the fuel at hand. Although it's an imperfect analogy, something similar happens in our cells during fasting. They make every effort to break down old clumps of proteins and tear down worn-out, inefficient mitochondria to make way for new ones. We're coming to understand that the accumulation of old clumps of protein contributes to or even causes some of the diseases associated with aging, such as Alzheimer's and Parkinson's. And just like old power plants, old mitochondria spew out toxic byproducts called reactive oxygen species that can damage the cell's DNA and other components, increasing the risk of cancer. The switch from burning sugar to using fatty acids and ketones sends off alarm bells within the cell that lead to a form of recycling called autophagy, but also the production of antioxidants and other molecules to help deal with the reactive oxygen species. As we'll learn in later videos, intermittent fasting is similar to exercise in that it imposes a stress to which the cell overreacts in a beneficial way, a process referred to as hormesis. We've covered a lot of ground in this video, so let's make sure you've got the big picture. When you eat, your cells are living the good life, with insulin acting like continuous room service. Even after a meal, for at least 12 hours or so, the liver keeps sending baskets of sugar to the door by breaking down glycogen. After that, the cell gets a rude awakening and suddenly has to worry if it'll ever eat again. The form of energy delivery is now fatty acids and ketones, which the cell realizes could run out at any time. So, all of a sudden, it gets serious and cleans up its act. Getting our cells into this fit and efficient mode is the main goal of intermittent fasting. How often do we need to do this and for how long? We'll cover that in the next video. Stay tuned.